Hey everyone, this is Richard.
And this is Linda.
Welcome to the Day Zero Gamer Infinite Live Show. It's show number 77 for May 5th, 2013. So, Iron Man 3 came out.
Yes, I went to see it.
Mm-hmm.
I don't go to the theater often, but I will go for Iron Man.
Heck yes. Apart from that, you have a good week?
Yeah.
Awesome. Same here. Iron Man was definitely the highlight.
Yes, I was going to say. You took the words right out of my mouth.
Yeah. Because that doesn't actually happen every week or month or year. So it was good. Very happy. Very happy to have seen Iron Man 3.
Yep.
Okay. So what is in store for us for this next week?
I have no new releases to report for this week.
Alrighty. Well, I say we then talk about what we've been playing. So for me, play some Halo 4.
Mm-hmm.
Dead Island Riptide, and some more Injustice Gods Among Us.
Very cool.
How about you?
I played some Halo 4 this week.
Nice.
And some Dead Island Riptide.
Woohoo!
Yeah.
Very, very nice. Okay, so let's just get right to it. So the news, big one here. The next Call of Duty is Call of Duty Ghosts. That launches November 5th, 2013.
Yeah.
So what do you think about that teaser trailer?
It definitely was a teaser. It doesn't tell you very much of anything. But I liked the ending, you know, after they go through all the different people and cultures. And then you have the silhouette of the guys.
Mm-hmm.
That's sick. Yeah. I thought that was cool. I want a poster like that.
Yeah, that's pretty cool.
Yeah, I'm excited mostly because I really, really, really hope that there's going to be at least some connection or some backstory of Ghosts from Modern Warfare.
Yeah.
So, I mean, the mask that guy wears is totally different.
Totally different. I was actually thinking it was just going to be a skull, but yeah, it's very different.
Yeah, I did not anticipate that. So I'm wondering if there's maybe a group of them or, I mean, it is plural, Ghosts.
Yeah, that's
so
true.
So we'll see. I am excited because I loved Ghost in Modern Warfare 2.
Yeah, and like we said last time, I mean, deviating from the Modern Warfare brand, so I think it's a good thing. Not that there's anything wrong with Modern Warfare, it's just this could be really refreshing, so.
Yeah.
So we got November to look forward to that.
Yep.
All right, so that aside, this is pretty cool. So Shenmue's Ryo Hazuki is going to have a statue.
Mm-hmm.
Pretty crazy. So there's going to be two different kinds. One that is with him standing on the Phoenix Mirror, and that is limited to 350 pieces worldwide. So that's pretty crazy because that's an extremely small print run.
Yeah.
And the second one is him. It's kind of like a street. I guess like the base is him standing on some sort of asphalt or I guess, like I said, a street. And that's limited to 750 pieces worldwide.
And that's
so,
still pretty rare.
Definitely a small run too. So pretty cool because Shenmue, I mean, you know, I'm a huge fan. And there isn't a whole lot of Shenmue merchandise, so this is great for fans and for those that just really want a statue. And he's actually 12 inches tall.
Yeah.
Which is pretty great. I mean, that's
pretty big. That's awesome.
1/6 scale, and it's made from polystone and hand painted as well. So.
And looking at both statues, the Phoenix Mirror one looks awesome.
Yeah, it looks really nice.
So if you can afford the slightly higher price, I'd try to get the Phoenix Mirror.
And it's not even that much more expensive.
I know.
I think it's like less than $20 more.
Isn't that crazy?
I know.
I think the Phoenix Mirror one looks awesome if you can get that.
Mm-hmm. I mean, the details, geez, on his jeans, and it's just, they did a really, really nice job. Yeah, I can't wait to see that in person. So, and here's hoping, geez, if they make a Landee, like a matching companion piece, and he's on like the Dragon Mirror, oh my gosh, that'd be fantastic. So we'll have to see. That'd be really great. But regardless, Ryo, so that's cool.
Yeah.
Next is Splinter Cell Blacklist. The Spies versus Mercs gameplay trailer has been released. So finally. I was a very, very, very big fan of Spies versus Mercs in Pandora Tomorrow and, of course, Chaos Theory, which that was the best. Once we went to Double Agent, it kind of went downhill. But I'm really hoping that this is going to kind of recapture some of that Chaos Theory action because that was a lot of fun.
Yeah.
One of my favorite modes. Definitely favorite multiplayer. That was really cool. So excited to play that.
Mm-hmm.
And lastly, this is some bad news to me, at least. So Kevin Conroy, he's not going to reprise his Batman role for Batman Arkham Origins. So apparently they wanted a younger sounding actor instead of Kevin Conroy because this is a prequel. And so they wanted somebody that would sound younger. I guess that makes sense if you think about it, but I don't know. And forgive me here because I'm going to be ranting a little bit. I'm not a fan of this trend, you know, with them replacing voice actors for, I guess, for any other reason other than, well, it's just they don't want to do it anymore, you know, something like that. Because, I mean, let's think about it. Let's just take a step back. Halo 4, Forward Unto Dawn. I mean, you've watched it. I watched it. I thought it was a pretty good movie. Mm-hmm. It has Master Chief in it, and it's not voiced by Steve Downes. And so 343 came out and said, look, you know, we actually had him record some lines, and, well, we wanted somebody that was younger because Master Chief is younger in that. And so we tried to digitally adjust his voice, but he sounded like a chipmunk. So we decided, you know what? Let's get somebody else that can sound maybe as though he will sound later on like Steve Downes. And so what's up with that? I mean, really, think about that. If they would have had Steve Downes doing the voice, I don't think that there would have been anybody going, you know, hey, guys, 343, I think everybody would have been like, that's no problem. I mean, I don't think anybody would have thought twice about it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? But see, here's the thing, is because they replaced it, then it became an issue. It's as though they made an issue out of nothing. And to me, that's a little frustrating, especially as a fan. And so let's extend that to Batman. So here it is. Batman Arkham Origins comes out. Kevin Conroy's talking. Nobody, I think, really would have been like, oh, geez, no, they shouldn't have had him. They should have had somebody else. But because they chose someone else, now it became an issue. It wasn't an issue before. I don't think it would have been one, but now it created one. And if you think about it, with the Batman animated series, it's from the 90s. I mean, he's been doing this for a long, long time. Mm-hmm. And there's even flashbacks in, I think, one of the movies, The Mask of the Phantasm, where he's kind of like starting off and it's his same voice, you know, and it works. It's just one of those things where it's more authentic to have the person who's been doing it continue to do it, even though maybe somebody or a couple people or even a group of people that have to suspend the belief is like, okay, yeah, I guess he's younger, versus everybody else that's going to have to suspend belief as though, really, this is the same Batman? Let's talk Iron Man. Heck, we just saw it. So if we want to see Iron Man, and all of a sudden, okay, there's Iron Man, everything's fine. But as soon as he takes off the suit, it's a different person. How would you feel?
I'd throw something at the screen.
Because, yeah, I mean, we're going there to see, of course, Iron Man, but we're also going, at least some of us, to see Tony Stark, but to see Robert Downey Jr.
It pulls you out of the immersion, for sure.
Yeah. So for this, for voice acting, at least for me, it's no different, really, because, yeah, I mean, it's an animated Batman, it's an animated Master Chief, or in Halo 4, Forward Unto Dawn's case, it was an actual person in a suit, but I'm there for the actor as well, because the actor does a great job. I mean, I'm so used to hearing Mark Hamill as Joker, I'm so used to hearing Kevin Conroy as Batman, or Steve Downes as Master Chief, and now we talk about Splinter Cell, because you figure Sam Fisher is not going to be voiced by Michael Ironside anymore, and that's crazy, because he's been doing it since it started. It's just, I mean, I understand that somebody came up with the idea or a group of people came up with the idea that's like, well, let's change things up. And I know there's a reason behind it. But at the same time, it's frustrating for us fans who really want that authenticity, really want that character to stay alive. And instead of retiring the character or just keeping the same voice actor because they're willing to do it, they change it up. And it just, I don't know, it takes away from the experience, I think. So there you go. That's my rant. I had to get that out.
Yeah, for me, it's more, it bothers me when people want to change it up just to change it up because they want to make it their own. That's what it feels like sometimes, because sometimes you hear the reason and it's like, is that really the reason? Or is it an excuse for you to really turn this into your own thing because you don't want to identify with the original?
Yeah.
And that's frustrating to me.
It is.
As for Batman, I'm thinking instead of going for younger, let's go older, Adam West.
All right, seriously? if they had a new Batman Arkham game and he's older and he's voiced by Adam West, all right, seriously. I love you, Kevin Conroy, but yeah, I'll take that. Because he was Batman before that.
Really, really cool.
That would absolutely be fantastic. Okay, all right, I stand corrected. There can be a reason to replace the voice actor and keep it the same continuity, the same lore and universe. As long as it's Adam West, because that would be great. Touche, Linda. Touche.
Thank you. Thank you. Taking my bows.
Ah. Well, there you go.
Yeah.
So that's the news. That wraps it up.
A lot of exciting stuff.
Yeah. Yeah. Some great stuff. And we'll see. I mean, this new voice actor, he might be perfectly fine. So we'll have to just see. All right. So let's move on to the retro game. So this one's kind of a funky one. I don't know really why we
picked... little fishy.
Yeah. So the game is Sega Bass Fishing for the Sega Dreamcast. Now, I don't know what we're going to talk about, to be honest with you, because it's a fishing game, you know? But hey, let's see what we can do. So, all right, for me, craziest thing back when this first came out, it was the fact that you could play it not with a controller. Well, I guess it's a controller. Not with the gamepad, the traditional controller. But you could use the Sega Fishing Controller. And this is, of course, before the Wii, you know, before there's all sorts of funky attachments and I guess the things, the accessories that make you feel like you're in the world, you know, like with swords and all sorts of stuff. So Sega busted out a fishing controller and it had motion.
I love that.
I thought that was pretty cool. Like I said, the motion was awesome and the game itself was actually pretty fun. I mean, the graphics for the time, the fish, they seemed very realistic and it was cool. I think that's neat. The fishing controller, if there wasn't a controller, I think it would have been, meh. I don't think I would have.
Yeah, I know. If you had to play with the regular controller.
Yeah.
I don't think, yeah.
I don't think
it wouldn't have gone off very well.
Yeah. I mean, it would have, I'm sure, you know, some people would play it, but, yeah, I don't think I would have cared. But because there was a fishing controller, it totally caught my eye. Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. And now, when I think about that, I think about Big Bang Theory, the episode where Leonard fishes with Penny's dad. They're sitting in his living room, and her dad, he picks up the phone, and he's all like, I'm fishing with Leonard right here in his living room.
Yep.
Even though that was on the Wii, it still made me think of it.
Yeah. You know what's actually really cool, too?
What?
You could use this and play other games. The controller, that is, not the game itself. I mean, you can't use Bass Fishing to play other games, but you could use the fishing controller.
I hadn't thought about that.
Yeah, so I actually tried it out with Soul Calibur back in the day.
What?
And there's actually people on YouTube that have actually recorded and done the same thing. Yeah, you can actually play Soul Calibur with the fishing controller. You got to swing it around, too, which is crazy.
Okay, that's crazy.
Yeah. Isn't that neat, though? I think that's really, really cool. I know it wasn't
beginnings
intended.
Of a Wiimote, like...
Pretty much.
Wow.
I swear, Sega
I hadn't
was
even thought about that.
Yeah.
That's so smart.
Yeah, because you can try to use an arcade stick to play different games and stuff like that. So I thought, hey, why not? So I had the fishing controller in, and me being the Soul Calibur fan I am, hey, let's try it out, because that'd be kind of cool. And it worked. It actually recognized the motion and, you know, the buttons and stuff like that. So it was pretty cool. So for those that have that, Soul Calibur and the fishing controller, try it out. It's very interesting.
Wow.
Mm-hmm. But yeah,
Sega. I totally want to check that out now.
They're awesome. I mean, they came up with so many crazy, cool things that down the line, years and years and years later, I mean, it's still happening. So pretty cool.
That is very cool.
And there we go. That is Sega Bass Fishing. Good stuff.
Awesome. Well, we wanted to thank everyone who took the time to listen to the show. Be on the lookout next Sunday for show number 78. Special thanks to Ronald Jenkins for providing Disorganized Fun for the Infinite Lives Show theme song.
Have a great week, guys.